Disclaimer, this is not a normal episode. In fact, it is an episode with just Adam and me, Nick, yeah. And we are watching Hell's Bells, The Dangers of Rock and Roll, which you can watch for free on YouTube, and we recommend you do.
Yeah, please don't give these people money.
Please don't give these people money. So watch it for free on YouTube, then listen to the episode. You can probably also just listen to the episode without watching it. We will describe things that you would have seen. Yeah. So thanks everybody for listening. Thanks for supporting. Hope you enjoy the show. Virgin, where each and every week my friends Alan and Adam recount Bible stories from their childhoods to me. I've never heard them before. My name is Nick.
And my name is Adam.
And straight from the devil's influence, we bring you episode 69.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Or 666?
Nine.
That's the real devil's number.
Uh-huh.
It's when the devil's doing a 69, it's a 6669. Oh, how is that joke not? That joke has got to been made.
So here we are with the second day of the seminar.
Oh yeah.
Which did you get that intro portion?
Yeah, I was going to ask if you got it too. I wasn't sure.
Yeah. So this is part two of Hell's Bells.
They'll come and do apparently they'll come to your church and give you a live presentation.
They'll go, anywhere, I believe. It said that they would go to any private engagement.
That's what I heard too. So if you're really interested in breaking quarantine, I guess this is an option.
Yeah. Call this guy from fucking Florida to come to your house.
Yeah, that seems...
I'm sorry, all of our Florida listeners.
Yeah, I mean...
Yeah. So yeah, this is David Dalton's second day seminar.
call him Christian Randy Johnson.
Perfect. It did get me thinking, halfway through this, I thought, oh shit, it's episode 69. I didn't even think about that. And then I was like, oh shit, maybe it's Satan working through me. Because the whole premise of this second half, which is all under one heading, which is the fruit of rock.
But it was like fruit of rock continued?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because there was like a little bit of like drugs and sex, yeah, you know, like fallout. Murder, ?
Yeah, I still have, I have questions about their chapter headings. And
yes,
it feels like, and maybe this is just me, you try to generally break your sections up into sort of equal parts.
Mm-hmm.
This is not that.
Absolutely not. And that's, it makes it hard to do something like this because I am like trying to, you know, like keep notes in separate chunks. And this is just one chunk.
Right.
And a theme throughout this entire second portion is that it all feels like it's a bit more of a stretch. Like the whole, don't get me wrong, the whole first part is bullshit too, but
right,
the whole first part was like, look at this offensive crucifix imagery on this album art.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
it's
yeah,
like, okay, yes, that is that. That's what that is.
The first half is all logical fallacies. Like mm-hmm, it's all if this then that. And like, or like straw man, it's all logical fallacies. The mm-hmm second half is just complete illogical jumps.
Yeah, totally. Here's our religion part of the program. It's all under this guise of, but this is logical.
Yeah.
You know, like
like the blood of Jesus covers all of these illogical.
Right. There's lots of like, this
things
is disproven by right this psalm.
Right.
Let's get into it.
Okay.
Well, first I want to ask if your reaction to this was as triggering as the first part.
Wasn't as triggering.
Okay.
And I think maybe it actually had to do with it being more far-fetched.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe like enough time has been that I don't know. I also just made like maybe like the last one just built up enough. Yeah. Like I have enough calluses that I'm like,
bring it on, David.
Yeah. It made me sad to same as the first part, but just like realizing like it almost makes you feel sad for like time lost. And like,
oh yeah.
Like I think of my childhood and like compared to, you know, the childhood of somebody else,
uh-huh,
where like things that should have been like, you know, Footloose and Fancy Free weren't because I was afraid that like the devil's going to get me through this music.
Sure.
Also, I also realized that like, I wasn't quite old enough to be listening to these bands, but like I missed, I think it was an Instagram message that somebody said that, their parents had taken them to a seminar on backmasking and that they like, it made them then obsessed with backmasking for a while after that.
Yeah.
And like, we talked about this before too, like how many people watch this thing and we're like, I just discovered a whole host of new bands to check out.
Absolutely. I was thinking a lot about that, especially when they presented the seminar idea, and I was like, okay, there's a certain age of kid, like young kids would find it's made to terrify young kids.
Yeah.
So, you know,
and their parents.
And their parents. So it would give up to a certain age, it would give you a complex and would, I think, probably be very effective in like
scare it straight sort of way.
Scaring you away from all of this stuff.
Totally.
But at a certain age, absolutely. It's like, wait, what's that album?
Right.
And I even did that a couple of times in this half where I was like, wait, what is that album cover? I love that.
So it's funny. Patti Smith is one of those names that I just kind of had floating around, but then like they did the demonstration of her like doing some sort of like anti-religious rant.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, Patti Smith's a lot cooler than I thought she was. So, 'cause like in my brain, I think I had, there's a Christian artist named Sandy Patty that a lot of us grew up with. And so like, I think in my brain I had conflated those two to be similar.
That's funny.
Like maybe Sandy Patty is the Christian version of Patti Smith. That is not at all what Patti Smith is.
Okay.
Patti Smith is a very cool person, which I actually got to like,
absolutely.
80s feminist.
Yep.
You know, anyway.
Totally. Well, and so that's also before we like get into excruciating detail, I wanted to ask you the question that you asked me the first half, which is watching the second half, who do you think that they have it most out for?
Oh, yeah.
And Patti Smith, I think, is up there, which is a weird one. Like it's not a marquee name, you know, like in the
that's kind of their MO. Like they did, I feel like they did get more into kind of the big names that I was expecting. They got more into Zeppelin. Mm-hmm. They hit Zeppelin harder. They hit some, the Beatles a little bit harder.
Rolling Stones.
They hit harder. They did a couple of, what was it? Wasps?
That's yes.
Wasp. I was like, I'm relatively up on my like 80s butt rock.
Yeah.
I've never heard of Wasp.
That is a perfect transition to start talking about this. Okay. So we're in the fruit of rock, and the first fruit of rock that they talk about is Rebellion.
Man, they hit that hard.
And the first artist that they talk about when they talk about Rebellion is Wasp.
Yeah.
And which is funny. I mean, so this is made in 89. I had to stop and immediately, you know, I'm 2 minutes into this thing and I'm immediately pausing it and looking shit up because I was pretty sure that Wasp is like a Christian thing now. And indeed, they're not like overtly Christian, but, Blackie Lawless has in recent interviews claimed that he's never playing a bunch of songs ever again because of his religious beliefs, including the hit song Animal Fuck Like a Beast.
Well, I mean,
Jesus, I just Christ. Thought that was a pretty funny pull, like to right off the bat.
Right. Just like
hit me with an artist that I was like, wait, aren't they Christian?
But the thing is like there is a weird part of me that I keep bumping into a lot of these people who are pushing pushing so hard against the Christian church, like the same people that he's railing against of just like being like showing overt Christianity and almost in a mocking way in the Rebellion. I kept thinking like all of these people are still passionately reacting to Christianity.
Yeah.
Like still like, and it's just like the other side of the same coin. And it's like being obsessed with the Antichrist and being obsessed with Christ is just like the same level of intensity, but coming from opposite sides.
Yeah.
Whereas like, I kind of took a sidestep out of the whole flow and like, I'm annoyed with religion in general for just fucking over like humanity.
Yeah.
But I'm not getting like, I don't feel like I need to like get into Satanism.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And this feels like that Wasp transition. Like, how many of these artists like basically felt conflicted their entire, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, that's the nice thing about getting out from under this feels like, oh, I'm not conflicted anymore. Like, that's the thing I was trying to get away from, was the confliction.
Yeah.
We're getting like away from like comedy podcast and into like post-Christian podcast territory. But like, it does not surprise me. I guess it doesn't surprise me at all that guy from Wasp is now like semi-Christian and like still trying to save a soul.
Yeah. They make the argument that rebellion is tied to witchcraft.
Mm-hmm.
And that
drugs came later in this.
Drugs came a little bit later.
But they also still tried. Everything goes back to witchcraft.
Everything goes batshit.
Goes batshit.
Everything goes back to witchcraft. They also mentioned that they're not talking about the good kind of rebellion.
I know. That felt a little tacked on because it felt like they were making this hard push towards like rebellion is evil, including like a verse from Samuel.
Yeah.
Or First Samuel.
Yeah.
About like how like, they're like, oh, wait. Like,
that's kind of our whole thing,
right? Like, we have some problems, like Americana wise, we have some problems if we don't address rebellion being a little bit okay. And then like anti-Catholic church stuff. Oh, loved shit.
Totally. And then they pivot to immediately going after a target, which I was kind of baffled by in 1989, to go against Live Aid.
Oh yeah.
I was like, no, are they going to,
but they think about it like they still see, like, he also went like after homosexuality pretty hard too.
Yeah.
I mean, of course he did. I mean, yes. The Christian church is still going pretty hard after it.
Yeah.
But like, of course they did. You know what I mean? Like,
yes.
And it baffled me too, but like, that's one of those things that has aged so poorly where like you get so far away from it that even the Christian church is like, well, I mean, Live Aid actually did do like quite a bit of help.
So I looked it up. Live Aid at the time raised £1.2 million. Their argument here is that they basically sent it to communists.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I think for the first time in the movie that I can recall, but definitely not the last time in this second part.
Yeah.
You get the first clips of like actually religious, like stock footage of
missionaries.
Yeah. And like the back to back, like
you get
somebody air humping on stage and then you get a shot of a, you know,
like two
25-year-old white lady. Yes.
Doing hand gestures.
Doing like weird liturgical dances. Yes. And playing acoustic guitars for brown children.
Right. And then, and the children just like staring going, what the fuck is going on?
And then voiced over with the like, which do you think helps more?
I know.
And I was like, I mean, probably the shit tons of money helps more. I don't know.
Yeah. It's yeah.
Wow. It ooked me out a little bit and I got a little bit nervous. I was kind of like, oh, is this whole second half of this going to be just turning this all on its head? We're not going to get the music video review. We're not going to get the cool album
art. And we didn't as much. We got the album art.
We didn't.
But not the music video review.
Right, yeah.
No, and it's totally, it's so weird because like a lot of the, within Christianity, the culture changed quite a bit. I would say like post 2000, a lot of Christianity got like semi-liberal again.
Yeah.
And then kind of like fell off the map again.
Sure.
But like, I feel like we're seeing a chunk of Christianity that was very like stuck in the late 80s.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Versus an ideal of Christianity that like continued on.
Yeah.
That being said, like there's still chunks of it where like of a good chunk of Christianity didn't move on from those mentalities.
Yeah.
Which is,
of course,
I realize that that's kind of like human nature. Like, you know, chunks of society move forward and chunks don't. And thus we have conflict.
Yeah.
But like this also felt like the beginning of a very, I wouldn't say subtle, but subtle racism also started, and definite classism.
Oh, we're getting to the
against
good
Africa
racist chunk
pretty
shortly.
Badly.
Yeah. We will almost certainly do a more on Satanic Panic stuff that is not strictly based on this one film.
Right.
But I kind of feel like the timing of that is kind of like, there are like cultural moments where you get these like last gasps of regulators of culture who realize that something is out of the bag. They are grasping at straws to try and like get that back in.
Yeah.
And you can sense the futility in this.
Yes.
You know, like they're doing this entire time is talking about how successful all these people are.
Right.
And how many millions of people listen to and enjoy this. And they're just like, please don't. I don't know.
Stop. Oh, no. Oh, God. Oh, no.
Yeah. So
that's a great way of describing it, though. It's exactly that. And it's also like we're 5 years from like big internet boom.
Right. Yes.
You know what I mean? Like
totally. And so like the scariness of MTV immediately goes out the window as soon as everybody can look at porn whenever they want.
Right. Right. Like it's weird how a lot of these arguments just like disappear. mainly because they just like got way lost in the dust. But then also thinking about musically, like those arguments had last gasps in the late 90s, mm-hmm. but by the time we hit 2000s, like most of the Christian church had kind of abandoned the idea that like rock music was inherently evil,
uh-huh.
which I know that he kind of is like, there's nothing. Well, we'll get to that when he starts talking about voodoo.
Yeah. Yeah.
But like, I mean, it's not news, but this is just like a fascinating look at how a conservative view of the world just makes you absolutely terrified of anything new.
Yes.
And then trying to couch it in terms that are fear. Like when you're trying to proselytize it, you couch it in terms that you know your audience will be terrified of.
Yep.
I don't know where I can't remember where our timeline was. Are we close to backmasking?
No. Okay. That's kind of the last thing of this section. But yes, I totally... We will get there. And I this entire section, I was giggling a lot at the things that they were purporting to like holding up as exemplars of what you should be scared of in rock music, especially as they start leaning away from mainstream like heavy metal.
Right.
Like the pulls that they start making.
Right.
I kept thinking of that reference that you made the first episode about just doing a LexisNexis search.
It's got to be
like, wow, this is like really niche. And why are they picking on this of all things?
There was something I'm trying to remember. It was some interview that they were pulling from, mm-hmm. and they were quoting. And I don't remember. The problem is I can't remember who they were quoting, but I think it might have been Jim Morrison.
Mm-hmm. They have some of his audio.
Some of his audio. And they had a couple of other, and it might not have been Jim Morrison for the other interview. It might've been Jimmy Page.
Okay.
Whatever. They were like, they're doing these quotes. And I was like, how many interviews did you guys pour over?
Absolutely. To find the one where he's bombed out in a hotel room talking about how the devil's inside of him or whatever, you know, like
blew me away. And like, I'm also thinking like, this is pre-internet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like,
they're watching the tapes.
Yeah.
Somebody's going through.
And maybe finding transcriptions somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But like they're reading the whole, they're not Googling, you know, Satan or finding Satan. Okay. Here's a chunk. Absolutely. Where he talks about Satan.
You got to admire the research, if nothing else.
I mean, it's a lot of fucking research.
So here we are. We go from, I think that this is a list that they're making. I'm not exactly sure. I went by the fun headings and screen caps that I got. So we go from rebellion to the occult.
Yeah.
The occult, they claim, is something that millions of young people ascribe to.
That surprised me.
It seemed high to me. Well,
it's up 10,000%. Just like
sure, yeah,
murder.
Yeah.
What was up 10,000%?
Crime. And then we get into this segment where you really get this like cringy sense that they have no appreciation for irony whatsoever.
None. Or
so we get to occult symbols.
Yeah.
We get to the pentagram.
Yep.
And you get all of the album covers that have the pentagram. You get people who are wearing the pentagram. You get I love the little zooms that they do when somebody's wearing it, but it's like, you know, buried kind of under a collar or whatever. Yes. And it zooms in.
Yes. Which those ones actually feel more legit to me than the one that's just literally just a pentagram. Like,
right. But this sense, this no sense of irony, I was like kind of raging about that, you know, like, okay, all of these people that you're showing are not Satanists.
No.
And but then I came around to the idea of like, so much of what we talk about comes from this idea of like biblical literalism. And so if you ascribe to that, then you also you have to believe that, like, well, you know, I hold the cross to be the most important, you know, symbol for me. And this person clearly is holding the pentagram
in
as
the same,
in the same. Yes.
And that's the problem with all of this is that literalism, it comes down to, this belief. And it actually kind of stems off of that, that same idea where like the people raging against Christianity and first, like, cause like Patti Smith in that, like that connection, like she's very angry.
Yes.
At the Christian church and probably rightfully so. I don't know what her experience is. I'm assuming that she has some pretty, I mean, I did a quick, she was a Jehovah's Witness. I think that like, she probably didn't have a great childhood and not a few really bad interactions that informed her position. But like, I'm realizing watching this, they are expecting you to come at these topics with the same level of intensity and energy and import. And I think, that's when like irony kicks in, is when you don't and you're going like, I'm wearing this because it's fucking funny that you think that this symbol does anything pragmatic.
Right. Or I think it looks badass or like, I thought it was a star.
Right. And then like you get like the post irony where you get people who are like making fun of. And like, I think of bands like The Darkness who like are taking on the tropes of like Satanic Panic era metal bands with literally no context associated.
Yeah.
It's just they're referencing. And it's such it's weird because you're seeing these like cycles of artistry happen that are terrifying the literalist Christians.
Yes.
And it's funny to what you're saying, like watch these things spin out. It's like AC/DC doesn't give a shit about religion.
Right.
Like
they,
I think all they give a shit about is like a beer boning and like classic cars.
Sure.
Like that's really all they care about.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
There's no like they're not sitting in their house. Like,
how are we going to take down the church?
Right.
Yeah,
and like, like have like a pentagram, like scrawled in blood and like, are like trying to channel. Like, no, they're not. They're watching like
totally
shitty movies.
And right. Exactly. And I think that later on in this part, he kind of addresses that and, but for the moment anyway, he has to hold on to the idea that this is serious.
Yeah.
He goes through the pentagram. He then goes to the El Cronado.
I did not know that was the name.
Okay. I was going to ask you about this. I was like, okay, this is a King James Virgin thing. A religious people call the devil horn sign El Cronado.
No. There was, I will say, and actually, listeners out there, please send us a voicemail if you remember this argument about the difference between doing. I'll see if I can describe the hand signal. So there was a distinct, overall, we were encouraged to make the American Sign Language I love you symbol.
Sure.
Instead of devil horns.
Yes. So that is your thumb out, index finger and pinky
up and your ring and middle finger down. Mm-hmm. So that was what we were encouraged to do. But it wasn't considered bad if you did the rock on symbol, which is with your pinky and your index extended and your thumb holding your ring and
so it looks like the devil horn thing.
Right. But where it becomes the devil horns is when you make it into a skull and point out your middle finger, ring finger and thumb to make kind of what looks like a fox?
Sheep or something.
This was considered the bad one.
Which I will say, I have never at a concert seen anybody do that. And in fact, if they did, I'd be like, what is that guy
doing? Right. That was like, this is the true devil one. And then the like with your thumb holding them in, that was like,
wow.
I'm telling you, man, this is an extension of that weird literalism bullshit. But I would love to know if this is just a weird microcosm. Because every once in a while we run into these things where like I experienced something and Alan had no awareness of this. But out there,
that's fascinating.
Like extra Christian land, was this a thing that you were aware of?
What were you allowed to do with your hands,
right,
listeners?
I also say, like, I went to high school between 98 and 2002, so that might also like help with placing this in context.
Yeah. So, and this is the first time that you really get the audience involvement element in this series. So, like, you know, this is all usually focused on these evil influences in the form of these rock stars. But the El Cronado, Devil Fingers, whatever the fuck. I mean, it sounds cooler.
Yeah. Well, they hold on. I got to look at what Cronado is and like it because it's just Spanish.
Yes.
I wonder if he was trying to say El Coronado.
Maybe because it was Cronado.
That's what I heard too. But Coronado isn't a word. El Coronado, but Coronado is the crown.
Which kind maybe? Of makes sense.
Anyway, if anybody knows.
So this is the first time that that satanic influence is specifically being exhibited in like masses of people. And they start talking about how these unsuspecting people don't even know that that's what they're doing.
I will say there were some people in that I did not expect to be throwing like the I don't know what we're going to call it. It's the devil horns. Yeah, the rock. Yeah, like was it Rick James was in the middle there? It's like
Rick James.
What
was
the
in
fuck
there?
Is Rick James doing
totally.
Throwing
that? Right. And so they were saying that to give these fans the benefit of the doubt, they're the victims of these spiritual forces that are taking them over.
Hell yeah, man.
They're not actually in control of what they're doing or whatever. And here's where that literalism starts to fault them, because then I'm like, well, wait a minute. You don't believe in like witchcraft or shit, you know, like.
No. Oh, they do. No, they very much believe in witchcraft, but they believe it's being like, so like when you do this, you have to like, there's these, you're stepping into magic logic.
Yeah. Great.
Because when Satan falls, he still retains a measure of his power.
Right.
But not all of it, which is also confusing, because if God can remove some of it, then why doesn't he just remove all of it?
Sure.
There's a lot of these things that we're just going to gloss over.
Right.
So witchcraft is basically tapping it in the same way that prayer would be tapping into God's power.
Yep.
Witchcraft is tapping into Satan's power.
Okay. Lovely. Great.
Just think of it like mana. Like
okay.
It's like,
yeah. Okay, great. That makes sense to me.
Yeah.
That works for me. Then we also get the symbol of the 666, which we've talked about on here.
Zoso,
which was Jimmy Page's thing.
I thought Zoso was just like the person that shows up in the Ouija board. Isn't that Zoso? Like, isn't Zoso just like?
Oh, I'd not heard that. We do talk about Ouija boards.
Yeah. Well, no. Like, it's one of those things that like people. I had understood that Zoso was one of the people that can quote unquote show up when you are using a Ouija board
and guides
you're theoretically talking to this demon named Zoso.
Oh, interesting.
At whatever.
You're talking to Jimmy Page himself.
Apparently, even though he's still alive.
Hold on. I got to go.
I got to call
the Ouija board.
It's like, apples.
Don't you have people for that?
Right.
No, it's me.
Well, apparently he named Cheap Trick. Didn't know that.
Nope. Okay. So, and then we start to take a dive out of hard rock into post punk and like indie bands.
Yeah.
And he starts claiming that they are more dangerous basically because they're eloquent.
Yes.
And like have more words.
Yes.
And that the purest manifestation of evil is exhibited in them because they're like infiltrators. And Will talked about this when we were like, he gave me that rationale when I asked like, well, how as a pastor, how do you say that it's okay that bad people exist in your congregation? And it was exhibited here when it said, well, the purest manifestation of evil comes from within.
Right.
And so these people, these post-punks who are wearing crosses and like even identify as Christian or like conflicted in some way, they are the most evil.
Yes.
Which is just fucking wild to me.
I mean, like from a certain extent, like I will say from a purely like argument, like argumentative, like I am more scared. That's not true. I was going to say I'm more scared of like
Morrissey.
Yes, I'm definitely more scared of Morrissey. No, I was thinking like in a political sense, like I'm more frustrated by like corporatist Democrats.
Absolutely.
I probably would have said that I'm more scared by them. At this point, no, it turns out that like crazy right-wing Republicans are insane.
Yes, right.
And we'll just stop at nothing. But like there is something to be said for people who are like part of your group in name only, but in action tend to go in a, like whatever. I think that the argument is bullshit that that's what these people are.
Sure.
But I guess I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt that maybe there are people.
I just don't buy that these people, like, once again, these people are not trying to deceive anybody.
No,
they're not, you know, coming into
churches, no clandestine agenda,
passing out the demo tapes and being like, no, it's cool, I'm one of you.
That's the insanity, is the assumption of clandestine agenda that like all of these people are trying to move the forces of evil forward.
Right.
Like, man, they can't even get their lives together enough to like, you know, show up to an interview on time.
Yeah. Right. Which brings us to the racist bit. We're at voodoo. Racism.
And as soon as they started saying that, started in Africa, brought to America by slaves, I was like, oh, this is not going to go well.
Yeah, this section is problematic for a billion reasons. It was funny because when they brought it up, I was like, I kind of got excited. I was like, oh, this is unsuspect. Like, oh, okay, voodoo element.
Start with Jimi Hendrix?
That's like the first main example that they give. Yeah, totally. But yes, they absolutely say voodoo became jazz music, which became R&B.
Yeah, which became rock.
Which became rock. And I was just like, damn, this shit's racist.
Yeah.
And we start to get he starts to describe what voodoo is, and I think only confused me more, because I had like this notion
it
of
went like round and round and round, and finally at the end it's like, you know, voodoo is nothing but sorcery. And I was like, why didn't you just say that from the beginning?
Yeah, this was,
because you made it a whole lot murkier.
This was a pull, it seemed like, from what he was pulling. Like, there were a handful of artists who were way interested in like going to places not in the United States, pulling samples from places, and I think that's like what sets this chapter up. It doesn't make sense at all to me now.
I was gonna say, it got also like kind of murky because they were talking about Aleister Crowley for a while, and that made more sense.
We'll get there, yeah. So they start out by talking about that we get some of that rhythm thing that you were talking about before.
Oh yeah, the one in three or the two in the four.
Yep. And so who is the artist, helped me understand.
Who is the rhythm? There was someone that they had like a percussionist. Was it a percussionist? There was the main percussionist for somebody, and I can't remember the artist. The artist didn't like was a surprise pull to me. And it wasn't Hendrix, I don't think.
Oh, well, the surprise to me was David Byrne.
That's what it was.
Yes.
Oh, was it David Byrne? Is that what I'm thinking of? There was one where like their percussionist was talking about how they were using the same rhythms that their father had, and their father was like a voodoo priest in Africa.
Oh, this one was weird. Yeah, who was that?
It was somebody who was like, I mean, it's not, but like in my brain, it's like someone like Bruce Springsteen or somebody.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, what? Yeah, do you remember what I'm talking about?
Yeah, though? I know what you're talking about.
Anyway, it was it was exactly what I was talking about. Like that two in the four, one in the three thing where it's like they're taking straight up rhythms straight out of the devil's handbook.
Yeah, totally. So that made me uncomfortable for you. Hmm. But you know, you called it.
Yeah.
So points.
Yeah. I mean, I guess eighth grade was still a total loss.
Yeah. So yeah, we get, David Byrne, who is condemned because he likes black people, apparently.
I mean,
A lot of showing him with black people.
I know.
And
that was a little like, yeah.
And then that takes us. This is not a separate section, but it goes into that Pan.
Yeah.
Is in this same section, which didn't make any sense to me at all. Because you're starting to talk now about a mythological figure.
Well, yeah. So this is a thing where it gets, that got interesting to me because like there's two positions that you can hold.
Mm-hmm.
The first one, which I had understood Christianity to believe, is God is the only God, mm-hmm. full stop.
Yeah.
That Yahweh, Jehovah, however Allah is like a singular individual.
Mm-hmm.
God.
Mm-hmm.
There are no others. Everybody else is a mythology, not even like fake gods. They probably didn't exist.
Yeah. And people who believe them are just wrong.
Correct.
Yeah.
And that was the way that was the way it was taught in my circles. Sure.
Yep.
There's another kind of school where it's a similar idea, but instead of being the only one, he's the guy on top.
Mm-hmm.
That everything else is a lesser God.
Uh-huh.
And that's kind of like, and this is why it got confusing to me as a kid, because that's kind of more the way that the like the Old Testament reads when you start like them talking about, you know, the different gods.
Yep.
And they're actually like these, you know, especially as we're doing these stories, you know, like the worship of Baal.
Yeah.
The worshipers have some measure of power from their god.
Totally.
You know what I mean?
It's acknowledged.
Right. Which that was glossed over heavily. And so like in this thing, it feels like they're going more for that latter perspective where Pan is a deity, just a lesser evil deity, which like opens up a lot of possibilities.
It really does.
I guess I could see this if what they're saying is more it's the former where there are no other gods. These are just like skins that the devil puts on to pretend to be.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the
but they really do focus specifically on Pan as like a separate entity. And
right.
like it's they seem to acknowledge that he exists in some way because they take it at face value that musicians who are on a drug trip are saying that Pan's in the room.
Right. Maybe it's just me, but like, Pan doesn't come up in a lot of conversations I have.
I've rarely talked about Pan. Maybe now Pan is dead.
Maybe that's the thing. It's like, were bands in the 70s just like, was Pan a regular person that popped up in conversations?
Yeah.
Like, I don't feel like Pan is as prolific. I will say, I want to see this Crest
Adam,
of Elton
can I
John.
Talk to you about Pan, our Lord and Savior?
I want to like when they were talking about Elton John's crest, like they featured. I was always like, how detailed is this crest? There's a picture of Pan just
in,
like
right
in hanging the out.
Yep. And okay, then that goes straight into again, and this is in the voodoo section, not the occult section.
Right.
We get into Crowley.
Right, which that's misplaced.
Definitely should go in the occult section.
Which I think he actually says like father of like occultism.
Yes, I don't think that there's really a voodoo connection. So this starts to get us really off the rails and in the weeds because we start going into a mini documentary on Crowley.
Yeah, I was going to say, I learned some things about Crowley in here. I was like, this is not where I should be learning some things about Crowley.
No, absolutely not. And so I wanted to ask you if growing up you had any like idea who Crowley was,
not at
or
all.
Like, okay. I just wondered if he was ever set up in Christianity as a bad guy.
Yes, but not in my family.
Mm-hmm.
My parents are fairly, like, I'm realizing we're fairly pragmatic.
Yeah.
And so like where their Christian faith touched reality is where they spend most of their time educationally.
Yeah.
So we didn't spend a lot of time on like biblical warfare or like or religious or spiritual warfare, any of the, like the things that you couldn't tangibly interact with. I mean, like in all honesty, like most of the stuff that my parents really like focused on was like social justice issues and
sure.
And what's funny is, and I think I've talked about this, is like Adventism specifically like has a really strong history of social justice.
Yeah.
And like they focused most of their missionary work on disaster aid and medical help.
Mm-hmm.
Not all of it. There's definitely some proselytizing. But like that's also changed in the last few years as leadership has gotten more conservative and creepier. Mm-hmm. But like, I think that might be a denominational thing where,
yeah.
I mean, it's also Adventism also has a pretty strong spiritual warfare component. It just wasn't that big in our, like, it was more like, how can we help people?
Sure.
How can we make their lives better? Can we do, you know, can we serve the poor? Can we serve the hungry? Can we serve the people around us? And those pieces I'm still like pretty pro.
Yeah.
Where I'm not is when you're like, you know, like, yeah, we'll give you a meal, but you're going to have to like listen to me try to convince you to change everything about you.
Of course. Yeah, I just thought it was an interesting. The Crowley pull was interesting to me because in this kind of feeling of this like last gasp type of thing, I was like, OK, 1989, this still seems like old news.
Yeah. Or way too early, because I feel like there's another like. We're a few, like, I feel like early internet also had a, like a new boom of Crowleyism.
Sure. Yeah, totally. And you know, like even pointing out things like they start to reach into like, well, his face is on the Beatles album cover. And it's like, everybody's face is on. What do you mean?
Right.
You know, like any famous, notorious person.
Yeah.
That's the idea.
The whole point like, was to pull like, you know, it's not this like- is our, it's the same, like, the Beatles are bigger than Jesus. Like it's the same. You like, you missed the whole point of the piece.
Right. Then we got to, so I was playing a fun game while I was doing this, which was I was acting like the kid watching it.
Okay.
Who I presume is going like, please don't mention my favorite. Please don't mention my favorite. Please don't mention my favorite.
And then they did.
And then they kind of did. And I was like, damn it. And it, they go into this weird segment where they start talking about both Coil and Current 93. Do you know either of these artists?
I heard Current 93, mm-hmm. but I know nothing about, I've heard the name, but that's all I know about them.
So like,
would I enjoy them?
Maybe. And so what's funny about this is that you're starting to get into like avant-garde music,
right? They dip because it isn't the, they do a chunk where it's basically like even the stuff that's weirder.
Yes. So this is all under the umbrella of it's so inexplicable.
Right.
It must be satanic.
Yes.
There's nothing. We don't have imagery here. We don't have words. What it's weird this? Though, right?
Yeah.
It has to be.
That's right. Cause I feel like it's like nothing exemplifies like Satanism essentially more than I think Current 93 was like what he said.
Yes, like just like this is basically garbled noise.
Right.
Which, then we get to basically the last section that we're going to cover. And I was so thankful that we got here because this is what I was here for.
Backmasking.
Why is
that so hard to say? I keep wanting to say backmasking, but it's backmasking.
Yes. The world of backwards phenomena.
Jesus.
And he's in the VHS lab where he's prepared to play things forwards and backwards for you.
Yes.
He's going to play things forwards for you and then backwards three times every time.
I also just put a pause in here for a second. If we're assuming, especially when he starts getting into the like more subliminal messaging.
Yeah.
That these messages are put here unbeknownst to the artist.
Yes.
And are intended to infect your mind.
Yeah.
By playing them multiple times. Also, I will like, this is not related to Christianity, but in like pagan ritual is like doing things three times makes them true.
Yeah.
Or like has power.
Yes.
So if you were in a mindset of literal spiritualism, like spiritual warfare, you believe that these messages are meant to corrupt and manipulate the minds of your people.
Yeah.
Why would you play these horrible demonic messages three times?
Three times.
For your audience.
With the words on screen.
Yes.
And these are things that they had to play. But like, these aren't even things that you could readily access.
Nick, I think we are watching the work of the devil.
The devil produced this documentary.
Oh, shit. They will come to your church and they will live present to you the devil's messages.
Do not invite Florida Man to your church under any circumstances.
He is trying to convert you to Satan.
Oh, no.
I'm just saying, how many times do we say how many kids learned about bands that they wanted to hear after this thing?
How many times?
I'm just saying.
We've lost so many children.
God, we should be a propaganda machine for the whatever.
So we get some examples of backwards phenomena.
Right. Things are purposefully backwards.
Yes. We get Bauhaus. We get Venom. And he starts talking about how it's evident that this was done intentionally. Obviously, because it's literally backwards when you play it.
And he like basically gives them a pass for being like, they're just trying to sell records.
Yes. Yes.
Which
and
I was like,
and he, yes, this is the one and only time where he acknowledges that this is, that he says,
this is theater.
That this is quote, probably just three guys who like to get weird.
This is just, he like, you unraveled your entire back half of this argument by going like, eh, these guys probably don't mean it.
Yes. But Adam, in the case of ELO,
I know,
Queen, Cheap Trick, Rush, the live version.
Right. I also, but like, were they pulling Rush earlier? I was like, oh my God, you guys, this was definitely a LexisNexis pull because like, if you'd looked at all like Rush of all the bands, like specifically, I don't know why I'm getting like, I got so angry because like you didn't look at any of their catalog because the entire thing is literally a mythological like storytelling. Like they are the proto prog rock. I mean, the proto prog rock in the sense that like everything about them is in movements and in like, they're basically channeling Wagner as a concept. You can't just like go like this song.
Well, and specifically this live version.
Yeah. Yeah.
Played backwards. Okay. And this is one of those other things where I'm like, who are these people who are listening to all of this backwards to find this bullshit, especially a live cut. Like,
So
not only are you listening to every record backwards to try and pick up some shit, you are listening to every live performance backwards.
I have no idea. Also, I just love the idea of ELO being evil. Cheap Trick. I get it. Yeah, sure. Whatever. But like, and then Rush, I was like, okay, I get it, mm-hmm. but you also clearly don't know anything mm-hmm. about Rush. Also, I'm not a stan for Rush, so like, don't come at me, whatever. Yes, I think the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
I appreciate your defense of Rush.
Well, it's just a weird, like, it feels like if you like say anything about Rush and suddenly you're like, oh, you're a huge Rush fan. I was like, no, just whatever.
Right.
Anyway,
I'm easy because you just know that I'm not a fan of anything.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, I am very jealous of your ability to just be like ambivalent towards like Zeppelin and Rush.
Yeah. Well, that's why I was like, I felt like I was kind of winning this entire thing. So I was just like, great. I don't like any of these fucking bands.
Great. You're all evil.
And then inexplicably satanic music. And I was like, oh, come on.
It just came right for your jugular. It's like, and Nick, you're evil.
Then we get this, this is the last portion that we'll talk about, and it kind of epitomizes the whole thing.
Yeah.
Because it has like four different logical leaps that are not correct philosophically in any way and presented as fact.
Yep.
Which is that, so when you get to these things where there are messages that you can only kind of vaguely get playing them backwards, like Start to Smoke Marijuana.
That was
from the Queen song.
That was so good. They had to pull back to, anyway.
Yes. So he asks, how does it get there? And he says that there are three possible ways it could.
Only three.
Only three. But in the name of science, he went through with the three. one, you could do it, but intentionally.
Yep.
And experts have agreed that nobody could possibly be smart enough to be able to do this intentionally.
Okay.
So that,
excluding venom that you just like washed out.
Well, no, because this implies that you are able to compose something that you can sing straight through forwards,
right?
That will, when played backwards, reveal a message.
I'm trying to remember which one it was, but one of them I was looking.
I bet David Lynch could do it.
Oh yeah, for 100%. One of them I was looking away from that word just came out of my mouth very strangely. But I think I was like looking at email or something, and I wasn't looking at the
what the fuck, Adam?
I know, right? Wasn't looking at the screen when they were doing the playback, mm-hmm. and I like they played it the two times. It's like, what the fuck are they trying to get me to hear? Yes. And so I had to look at the lyrics, and I was like,
yeah,
all right.
And some of even their sentences are not. Like complete sentences.
They're not grammatically correct.
Like, I am
infernal.
Satan's infernal
right.
love.
Jesus is infernal.
Yeah,
It wasn't Jesus isn't for like Jesus infernal.
Uh-huh. It could have gotten there intentionally, but no. Nobody would be
possible.
Intelligent enough. It could have gotten there on accident, but I guess Christians don't believe in accidents.
No. No, everything is directed,
directed by
a force.
By God. So we know that that's right out.
Right.
So it has to be. And he said that this is the only rational explanation, that it is a spiritual force. Indeed, an outside intelligent force with supernatural power, one that is occasionally able to play an artist just as we can play instruments.
Yeah.
yeah. Boy. So I think that really frames the whole thing, right? Like it's a bizarre.
Yeah.
To say that is the only rational explanation.
It's very difficult to argue with because you're going, well, you're constantly proving a negative all of this going, those aren't you. The first two options that you had are more likely.
Sure.
And you just abandon them by experts with no citation.
Experts. Right.
And accidental, like
accidents just don't happen.
That's what it was. Yes, they do.
but and then to have the to put the words in your rational explanation, outside intelligent forces with supernatural power.
Hell yeah, man.
Is like,
how are you going to fight that one? Outside. What is like, I have no access to outside by definition. Like supernatural. Well, fuck me.
Yeah, yeah. No experts have confirmed or denied this, I guess.
Right.
Or they've only confirmed it.
Yeah, you can't do anything with it's. I mean, it goes back. It's like all this does seem to come back to me to this. Like everything is a like. I remember having an argument with my dad when I was in high school where he said like everything in your brain comes from one of two sources, either the devil or God. Essentially, it's like mm-hmm. It was the idea that every thought that comes into your brain.
Sure. You've got the two little angels on your shoulders.
That's exactly the argument. Yeah. And I kept going, it's like there is random shit in my brain that just pops out that like isn't evil, but has no order to it.
Uh-huh.
And my dad's argument would be essentially been like, well, that's just the devil just like throwing noise into the system. Mm. Essentially.
Mm hmm.
That's what all this is like you when you limit the field to supernatural forces, then the result or the I guess the results are all supernatural.
Right.
And then you don't have the ability to actually logically apply rationale.
Yeah.
Because you've taken it off the table.
Yes.
It's this weird cyclic thing. It's all the same thing where like it's like the literalism coming back to bite you where yes. Like you cannot just say anything is benign. Everything must be clandestine. Everything must be epic.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's the case, then like you find meaning in insane places,
Right.
I just like you find clandestine meaning in AC/DC.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, come on.
Right. And basically, that's when the presentation stops being fun at all.
Yeah.
And so we stopped there. We get to...
Nick was a little bit ahead of me in the viewing and like texting.
And I was like just stop. Abandon ship after backmasking. So then I will say I watched a little bit forward. I didn't want to make you do it for sure because I was like, ooh, this is going to be so cringy. Because we really start getting out of... showing you it,
right,
completely out of the
you're sold that this is evil.
Yes. So now we start getting little scripted acts.
Ooh. Well, like how to talk to your friends and family members.
Like, okay, so you remember in the first part at the fake concert with the egg?
Oh, hell yeah.
Where all those concert goers
just bring eggs to people.
He starts interviewing the concert goers as like, why do you like rock music? Or and he started going through the defenses that fans have for liking rock music and like how like even like a Christian fan could potentially rationalize enjoying it. And so he's like interviewing and it's made to look real. Like it's absolutely made to look like these are just random interviews with rock fans.
Right.
It's so fucked up. And then it goes into, and this is where I had to stop because I was like, I can't get through this. He then is sitting on a hospital bed with a man who he says is in critical condition and he's about to die and he's going to go to hell because he liked rock music. And he's got like an oxygen mask on, you know, like this guy is fucking in this hospital bed. And then they start going through why he's going to hell. And rather than using real music, they have a fake band start playing around the hospital bed, like a fake hair metal band called Van Treese and the Duh Lights. And they're like basically singing like over the top, like satanic lyrics to him. And then they have a Whitney Houston impersonator come and do the same thing because they say that like she's so sweet. Like, how could she be bad? But she's singing about love that isn't between man and God. She's singing about love that's between two people. And so he's still going to go to hell listening to Whitney Houston, Jesus. But he could be saved, .. And then I was like, abandon ship. So I'm glad you didn't have to go through that, but I did.
Yeah.
It was a pretty wild ride. Adam, final thoughts, star rating out of 5.
3 stars out of 5.
Wow.
No, not zero, okay, not great. Zero. No, like this is, I did not enjoy this on a comedic level. I did not enjoy this on, I didn't enjoy this.
Yeah.
I just didn't enjoy it. Like, and it wasn't like a, like, oh, I feel like I didn't enjoy this on like, as an, a, like an intended audience perspective.
Yes.
Because I just, I'm not.
Right.
And then like, so the only other option I have is like in satire or in just like so bad it's good.
Yeah.
This is just, it makes me sad.
Yeah, totally.
Like, honestly, just makes me like, oh, this is people's reality.
Yep.
And that's, I mean, that, that was the triggering bit. It was like, it was triggering conversations that I'd had and like nights that I didn't sleep
right
as a kid.
Yeah.
And like that, I don't like, I don't want anybody to go through this.
Totally.
And it's, that just bums me the fuck out. That it does make me a little happy that somebody might discover like, you know, avant-garde rock or noise, or like somebody might discover, oh hell, somebody might just discover Venom if they enjoy. Venom's hard to, that's a hard one to.
I mean, you're looking up Patti Smith, so how about that?
Right.
Unintended consequence.
Exactly. Like I am happy about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because like you find joy. Great.
Yeah.
But like, God, the damage. And it, the thing is like, I don't think this movie did damage. I think the people who watched this movie did damage. If that makes any sort of sense.
Oh, sure.
Cause like, whatever.
Well, like, and in the seminar pitch, they start really harping on like how many people they've saved because of this.
Yeah. That's,
and I'm like, I was starting to get like, oh no. You know, like the stuff that isn't in the documentary, I was almost more terrified of.
Yeah. Yeah. No, and it gets like, we thought that the citations weren't here for this. Like the claims get astronomical in live shit. And like, even within like Christianity, like you start talking about souls you've saved. It's really funny. Like when you were talking about the guy in the hospital bed, like my Christian hackles went up. Not my post-Christian hackles.
Yeah.
Like I started getting really pissed and going like, you don't get to judge people. By definition.
Right.
You as a human have no ability and no right and are frankly breaking God's law by prejudging this individual.
Uh-huh.
Yes, I realize it's theater, but everything up until this point has been literal. We have to assume that this is literal as well.
Yeah.
By like the rules that you have set up.
Sure.
And so Christian Adam is going like, no, you right here, you actually broke the rules.
Yeah.
And you got it. Like you need to start atoning for your sins because,
right.
Well, you don't have to, but you don't get to judge people. That is God's purview and God's purview alone. And it's really funny because like I didn't think that I would get pissed about that. That like,
well, even in you guys doing the stories, I think the thing that like flags start flying for both of you guys when you're like, no. If you're going by the rules, you don't get to choose that this is the one time that you don't do
this
or that you do this.
Right.
You do it or you don't.
Right. Well, and that's the thing is like, you can ultimately like, and I think like the rebellion piece really hit on this. And there's a couple of pieces earlier in it too, but like, I mean, and we've talked about this, like religion is just another form of control. Like everything is literally just like, how do we control people? Because controlling people equals power.
Yeah.
And power gets you. At this point, I don't know because I don't have a whole lot of it. But like makes you feel better. You can do whatever you want, whatever. I mean, like the Christian church is, you know, specifically the Catholic church, but like Christian church in general is filled with examples. I mean, like televangelists of people just like billionaires who are, you know, raking in monetary gains from their population, as well as just like,
of course,
controlling nations and controlling.
I would say that real to real ministries is almost certainly one of them.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, I think watching this is weird because of having 31 years of like space.
Yeah.
You know, like, yes, we can laugh at like the dated references and the bands that they're choosing and like the funny things were like, you're like Little Early on Bobby Brown or like,
yeah,
you know, missing all these bands that are coming up and having one Beastie. They did another Beastie Boys.
666 Etching.
Where was that? I was looking for the 666 Etching. I couldn't see
It's, you know, like in the Matrix number or something, which honestly, like if you're talking about Matrix numbers, that very well could have been unintentional.
Just a random.
But there is not a such thing as unintentional.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah.
Also like a license to Hill is just makes me very happy that that's where it popped from. But like, the references became obvious. Oh, you were just literally trying to control. And that's the thing, like, totally. We've gotten distance from enough that we can start, like, we understand the mechanisms, we understand the, you know, like, and things have gotten subtler, but like, this shit's still happening.
Yeah.
Just in a different zone. They're no longer just like throwing, you know, venom at you and going, you know, evil. It's, I'm really to the point. It's like, if somebody is trying to tell you what to do, there's an agenda to it.
And absolutely.
If you agree with the agenda,
what to do or not to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Everything has an agenda.
Totally.
I don't know why I'm like feeling like I should like
absolutely
give, but like,
I think that's a perfect button to put on it. That does it. I do have one question for you, which is how likely are you to do the new metal one?
Oh, I'm in. Yeah. No, I'm like,
great.
I mean, cause like, what was funny is like a lot of the bands that they were referencing, I actually like, I enjoy even sometimes just ironically.
Yeah.
Or just like, what is it where you like you enjoy something, you know it's bad, you just don't care? It's like guilty pleasure. I guess, yeah, it's like, sure. Guilty pleasure types. Like a lot of the bands, like, but with new metal, I could not give a shit. Like, yeah, totally. All of those bands could just burn.
Yeah.
And so
someday maybe we will do number two, which involves new metal and hip hop. I'm a little bit nervous about the hip hop.
Oh, rightfully so.
I think that they're going to go the voodoo route and it's going to make me crawl out of my skin.
I'm just going to go straight up racism. Like, my guess is it will be urban violence, and they will harp on that, and essentially say that black people are violent by nature. Full stop.
Sure.
That is my prediction. Fuck. For what they're going to be saying.
Great.
Didn't they say that there's a movie one too?
There is a movie one, which also that sounds fun specifically for you.
Yeah. That one, I'm in it to win it. Cause I don't know. Music wise, I'm less informed.
Uh-huh.
Film, I feel like I could like, it's like, you don't understand mise-en-scene.
Yeah. we'll give it like a year.
Okay.
And we'll, maybe come back to do number two. Thank you all for listening to this.
Thank you so much for listening. You can follow us at KJV Pod on both Twitter and Instagram. And we'd love to hear from you on our prayer hotline. I know I asked you earlier about the devil horns versus rock horns thing. But in addition to that, if you watched this film or really had any experience,
or if you watched if you were forced to watch a similar film, right, growing up,
anything kind of like portraying rock music as like a tool of the devil. Mm-hmm. We'd love to hear your,
were you forced to throw a CD away?
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Just anything kind of in this genre. We'd love to, you know, kind of hear about your experiences. So if you are cool sharing that, record a voice memo and email it to DearJesus@KingJamesVirgin.com. Thanks to Mascaras and Resurrection Records for use for a theme song, Kixadi, off the album El Moran. And this week's Resurrection Records artist is Lacord. You can find links to these songs, to that email address, and back episodes, all sorts of things, on our website, KingJamesVirgin.com.
That does it for this week. Until next week. Are we to believe that celebrating the joys of sex and sadomasochism is really going to help the world?
Yeah.
Produced by Sonic Bazaar.